गुड इवनिंग ऑल, वेलकम टू इंटरनेशनल पीयर रिव्यू वर्कशॉप 2020 फॉरवर्ड बाय इनोवेटिव पब्लिकेशन प्रेजेंटिंग ऑल अबाउट पीयर रिव्यू. इफ यू आर हैविंग एनी डिफिकल्टीज रिगार्डिंग द ऑडियो एंड वीडियो ऑफ दिस वेबिनार, देन प्लीज लेट अस नो थ्रू कमेंट्स क्वेश्चन बॉक्स, वी विल ट्राई टू हेल्प यू आउट. दिस प्रोग्राम कंप्राइजेस 4 सेशन ईच ऑफ 80 मिनट्स on 19-20, which are completed, and today is 26th, and tomorrow next session. So every session is subdivided into 4 parts. First is introduction, then presentation by key speaker, question answer session, and thanks for vote. Today's topic covered is application of bibliometric, arithmetic, and psychometric to the peer review reference manager software. What it is and what can it do. The highlight of workshop is hands-on experience of peer review. Thanks for participation in peer review assignment 1 and 2. We got tremendous response of reviewers on this. 16 best reviewers are selected out of 130 entries. We received fantastic opinion for you all. You are all reviewed the article on the basis of average marks given by 3 expert team of we finalized the winner. We announced the winners of peer review assignment today. Quiz competition is held on tomorrow, 27 September. First 30 participants with correct answers is rewarded. To participate in quiz competition, please ensure your login details are correct to finalize the winner. This is the gift hamper. All gems were presenting international peer review workshop. You all knows now. About innovative publication is publisher in medical, dental, pharmacy, nursing, allied sciences. Innovative publishes high quality peer reviewed open access article in all specialties. Here are some reason to publish with us and experience our exceptional service. To know more, please visit www.ipinnovative.com and submit your manuscript at www.innopub.org. So I would like to introduce Dr. Amina Sultan, the first key speaker today. Dr. Amina Sultan is BDS, MDS, pediatric and preventive dentistry, professor and head of department in the Department of Pediatrics and Preventive Dentistry, Faculty of Dentistry, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi. She had numerous publication and presentation to her credit and has presented paper in various prestigious national and international conferences. Some of her oral presentation have won best presentation awards well. She is associated with many influential national and international journals as an editorial board member and a reviewer. She is a life member of several renowned associations like ISPPD, APD, and Indo-Pacific Academy for Forensic Odontology, Indian Society of Dental Traumatology. Welcome, Dr. Amina.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Nikita ma'am.
Then next speaker is Dr. Nitika Singh. She is BDS Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry. She has an academic experience of 8 years and is currently working as an associate professor at Bhojia Dental College and Hospital Badi, Himachal Pradesh. She is also a life member of Indian Society of Pediatrics and Preventive Dentistry and South Asian Association of Pediatric and Preventive Dentistry India. So she is an active speaker at many national and international conferences and has even chaired scientific sessions on international platform. She has made contribution dental literature through the articles and case studies. Dr. Kedar Mehta. Welcome Dr. Nitika Singh. Dr. Kedar Mehta. Dr. Mehta. Welcome. Dr. Mehta is MBBS MD Community Medicine and Assistant Professor in the Department of Community Medicine, GERMS, Medical College, Gauri Varodra. His area of interest including teaching research and scientific writing. He has more than 60 published articles in different national and international journals. He has been actively involved in various research projects carried out different departments of medical college. He has received a Young Scientist Award for his latest research publication in IACSM Gujarat State. Two times during 2014 and 2015. His international experience including the paper presentation in International Congress on HIV/AIDS and Dhaka, Bangladesh in March 2016. He has been facilitator of many national operational research courses in India conducted by International Union Against TB and Lung Diseases. Welcome, Dr. Kedar Mehta.
Thank you, madam.
Now, Dr. Lalit Gupta, you all are introduced. I introduced him before, but for today also, I will like to remind you all the details of him. Dr. Lalit Gupta is MBBS, DA, DNP, anesthesia, MNMS, associate professor in anesthesiology and intensive care in Maulana Azad Medical College and Associate Hospital, New Delhi. He has published 80 publications in esteemed national and international journals. He is reviewer and associated editor and editor-in-chief for more than 60 national and international journals. He has authored chapter in many books at national and international levels. He also authored books, Synopsis of Anesthesia and Drug in Anesthesia and Critical Care. He is a founder member of Anesthesia and Critical Care Foundation Society. He is a member of advisory board for International Conference of Toxicology and Education Training and Business in collaboration with ARSEAM Foundation and a member of National Advisory Board Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation and member of other various societies. His research interest is intensive care, remote area anesthesia management, difficulty airways, onco anesthesia, pain medicine, and palliative care. Welcome, Dr. Lalit Gupta.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, ma'am.
If you have any question, ask them in question box at the bottom of your screen. We will try to answer as many as unique questions as we can. If somehow we could not answer your questions due to time constraint, then you can email us your questions at the info@ipinnovative.com. Thank you. I would like to invite Dr. Amina and Dr. Nitika for an interactive, interesting session, which is very important topic in peer review. So I would like to invite you both. Please share your slide, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. I would like Dr. Nitika, please share the slide.
Yes, ma'am. Sharing it. Good evening, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Innovative Publications for providing us with such a wonderful platform to share our knowledge, and I hope that all the participants have a great learning experience with us all today, right? So I'll just start with the presentation. The topic is applications of bibliometrics, altmetrics, and scintometrics to peer review. So once the article is published, how do you count how many influence does it have, or how do you measure the impact of the article? So bibliometrics is the answer. It can be used for books, websites, conferences, policy statements, and even patents and evaluating scientific research. But before bibliometrics, peer review was the one which was always used to evaluate the scientific research. So why we switched on to bibliometrics, before that, before coming on to that, I would briefly discuss what peer review is and what are the major drawbacks in peer review which led to bibliometrics. So peer review is basically a process of subjecting an author's scholarly work, research, or ideas to scrutiny of others who are expert in the same field. So basically, it will help to validate the work, it will help to improve the quality, and also increase the networking possibilities within the research communication. Bibliometrics, next slide, ma'am. So review can be of many types: open review, single blind, double blind review. All this has been beautifully explained in our earlier workshop by the previous panelist. So I'll just be brushing through this slide. Now, there are many pros and cons for all the review processes, but still of total of what peer review is, there are many biases. Next slide, ma'am. Yes, it has been said that editorial peer review, although is widely used, is largely untested and its effects are very much uncertain. It is very difficult to detect error or plagiarism in a peer review. Also, in many of the scientific conferences and workshops that are conducted, many abstracts which are flown in are all accepted without thoroughly reviewing them, right? Because of the simple reason that more the acceptance, more are the number of registrations and more the money flows in, right? So again, this is one of the major points which is criticized for peer review. Again, it has been always argued that peer review has lowered the research quality by limiting the creativity among the researchers. That is, they repress the innovative ideas of young researchers or the bold question of the young researchers, which can actually make a paradigm shift in that particular field. And with the increase in the number of so many articles nowadays, because of the pressure of writing the articles, you know, and getting them accepted, the actual reviewers who are competent enough to review them are very few, right? So we need a process which can accelerate the reviewing process of all the scientific articles, because reviewing process in itself is a very time consuming process. It takes a lot and lot of time to sit and read and critically analyze an article. And of course, it is an unpaid activity. The reviewer is taking out his time and putting all the efforts to scrutinize an article, but in lieu of what? Nothing. He gets nothing in lieu of it. In fact, he's using his own time, which he can use to write his own scholarly articles or something productive, to put in a feedback for others. And again, one of the major drawbacks of peer reviewing is, even if the same article is reviewed by different people, you will never get the same results. So the results cannot be reproducible. So all these errors have eventually led us to bibliometrics, right? So now, with the current trend of increasing scientific publications every year, and with the increase in the technical and specialized part of these publications, the qualified reviewers are very much difficult to find. So in such environment, a number of boards and institutions and even countries are turning on to bibliometrics to facilitate the reviewing process. Of course, it is not an alternative, but definitely helping in reviewing of the process. The term bibliometrics was first coined by Petrarch in the year 1969. So it is basically the application of mathematical and statistical methods to books and other medias of communication. So it is a potential tool for evaluation, and it helps in quantitative analysis of publications. So basically what it does is it extracts data from the publications and analyze that data in various ways to answer questions about that research that those publications represent, right? So this what is bibliometrics is. And if bibliometrics is used in a very responsible manner, it can reduce biases. It is definitely a very transparent and a reproducible metric method, and it helps to guide review process by pointing out the irregularities in publications or citations. It can measure the impact of the scientific research, and also it is helpful to quantify and qualify your research, could be of individual or could be journal based. So from now onwards, I would request Dr. Amina Sultan to kindly explain to us what all are the bibliometric indicators which help in this quantification of the data. So over to you, Dr. Amina, and thank you so much for taking care of the screen.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Nitika. Thank you, Innovative Publication, for giving us such a opportunities. I'm feeling like it's an honor and a privilege to be part of this esteemed workshop. So after Nitika, she's covered so beautifully. She's just summarized whatsoever been covered by the other panelists so far. So I'll be taking over the diplomatic indicators. I'm just giving you a brief and a very simple understanding of this diplomatic indicators, and I'll tell you how we can calculate these indicators at our own level. So with this, I begin with the diplomatic indicator. And one thing I just want to make note in the beginning, now since there was a limitation of the time, the diplomatic indicator is a huge topic. So I'll be covering only the most important, most prevalent and most easy to understand indicators that a researcher will find it very useful in their research life or the scientific studies ahead. So bibliometric indicators can be broadly subdivided into quantitative bibliometric indicators, performance bibliometric indicators, and the structure bibliometric indicators. In this presentation, I'll be taking care of the quantitative and the performance-based indicators. As the name suggests, quantitative deals with the productivity of the researcher, and the performance involves the quality of the journal or the researcher. Now these bibliometric indicators, the first quantitative indicators, as the name suggests, we deal with the number of the paper that has been published, and this paper could be anything, the chapter of a book, it could be a journal article, it could be a newspaper clipping or any review or any blog, fine. So this provides an initial, simplified and approximate measure of the quantity of the work that has been put forward by the researcher. So we can say this quantitative indicator is a rough bibliometric indicator, and it's the simplest way. This is just giving us the number. Now this quantitative indicator does have a pitfall. Now since it's dealing with the quantity, it just gives us the idea of the number. It doesn't tell us about the quality of the publication. And in the cases, the multi-authored articles where the number of contributors are more than one, so this doesn't give an idea how much effort or how much contribution each author has made in preparing the manuscript. Now this number, the quantity, can be in some way can be counteracted by if we carefully analyze the kind of publication he has made. Like if it is a case report, or it is a clinical trial, it is a research publication, or it is a review article. Now all these kind of publication, they carry different weightages. So we can indirectly get an idea about the quality of the publication. Now the next come the performance based indicators. Now the performance based indicator can involve the journal or the researcher. So they can be journal performance indicators and the researcher performance indicator. Journal measures the quality of the journal, and the researcher performance indicators measure the quality of the researcher. It measures how impactful the researcher's study was to the scientific community. Now these researcher-based, these performance-based indicators, they are governed by certain metrics. These metrics can be article-based metrics or the journal-based metrics. The article-based metrics could be citation. Citation, as we know, it is the key metric. All our analysis, all the database, they all are governed, or they are extracting all these indexes through the citation only. This is a potential tool in the recruitment, career assessment, internal evaluation, and these days these citation analysis are also used, the domain has widened, they are also used for the university ranking, also ranking of the countries. Now the download means the number of time an article has been downloaded from the publisher website, such as PubMed or any accessible repository, and all these downloads, they are recorded in a online counter. This counter is an acronym, means counting online usage of the network electronic resources. Now there's a drawback with this. We know that article has been downloaded, PB doesn't know whether that article which was downloaded, was it for the read purpose or just to read, or it has been put forward like as cited in other publication. So the next the metrics is the F1000 rating. Now this is a post-publication peer review. Once the article is published, then it is scrutinized, and we can give the terms like recommended, must read, or exceptional. Now again, these scorings are translated into a numerical number, and we give a F1000 article factor. Now next come the journal level metrics. The journal level metrics again involve the citations and the journal impact factor. General impact factor, I'll be discussing a little more in the slides ahead. Now, citation involves all the articles that have been published in that journal. They attract some citation. So the citation general level metrics means that the total number of all the citation that have been received by the article that have been published in that particular journal over a given period of a time. It is time specific and it is calculating the citation of the article published in that journal. And the journal impact factor, that involves the prestige of the journal. The journal importance is based on the how much journal impact factor that the journal has. Now, how often the average article in a journal is cited in a given year gives you a journal impact factor. Now, for example, if a journal impact factor is one, that means that on an average, the article published 1 or 2 years ago have been cited once. Now, I'll be discussing general impact factor in brief. It was first proposed by E. Garfield in 1955, and later on, it was more refined in 60s by Garfield and Scher alone. Now, this number is not constant. It varies yearly, but it's still the most extensively and used indicator, quality indicator, and this tells you and guides you about the reputation of that journal in your specialization. And this is database specific. Like one database will give journal specific to PX, the other database may not give the same number. Fine, the number may vary. For example, the journal citation report, this give an impact factor for a particular journal as 3.219. See, you should always remember that it expressed in decimal, 3 digits after the decimal. See, if you come across such kind of a number, such kind of a configuration, it means the impact factor is fair, it is not fake. Now, what is the significance of this impact factor for a researcher? See, whenever we have a manuscript ready for a submission, we want to submit in some journal, we always look for the impact factor. Now, this will guide you. What is the status of that journal in your specialization? If it is a good and renowned journal, better impact factor, we'll always try to publish an article in that journal. Now, it will also be a potential tool in the management of the library journal collection. It will be helpful for the editorial policy that our publishers know very well. And the most important, it will also help in the research evaluation. The article published in a high impact journal will be better for the evaluation ahead. Now, how can we calculate it? Now, who are responsible for this impact factor calculation? Nobody can declare it themselves. No journal can declare it themselves. This is our impact factor. There are agencies responsible like Thomson Reuters, Journal Citation Report, Scopus and etc. As a researcher, we can also find the impact factor of a journal. We can go to a Web of Science. We can search. On the search, we can put the name of the journal. And the Web of Science itself gives you the list of the journal along with their impact factor. So it is very easy to choose the journal where we want to send an article to. Now, how it is calculated? Like this diagrammatic explanation, it will be very simple to say that in any given year, for example, this 2006, the number of citations received in that year from the article published during the two preceding years. Like suppose in 2006, we want to calculate the impact factor. So we have to calculate the citation received from the publication for the last two preceding years, that is 2004, 2005, and 2004. Fine. And this the numerator will be the total number of the citation, and the denominator will be the total number of the publication for those two preceding years. And this will give you the impact factor for this 2006. Now, for example, 2019, we want to calculate the impact factor of 2019. Then the article published in 2018 and 2017 will be the denominator, and the citation received for those publications in 2018 and 17 will be the numerator. And we have just put these random numbers, and this is the impact factor. Fine. It's not that this is a true number. This is just for their explanation. I have taken an example. Now, suppose this is an impact factor, the 2009, we are calculating a 2006, whatever year, this is the reference period, and we take a reference citation window of two preceding year. Now, this gives an impact factor. Now, it happens that there are certain articles of various fields like humanities and social sciences, where the articles, they take some time to be cited. For example, in genetics or in medical field, in the cancer field, the articles once you publish, they are cited earlier as compared to the article published in the field of history, humanities, and etc. Now, for this, we can extend the citation window for 5 years or 3 years. If we have a citation window of 5 years, we call it a 5-year impact factor. If we have a citation window for 3 years, we call it a 3-year impact factor. Now, this will give an appreciable amount of the impact factor as compared to the simple impact factor. Log the general impact factor for 2010 for a particular journal was 1.53 by calculating the citation divided by the total number of the publication. Now, the same art journal, the 5-year impact factor, when we took into the consideration of the citation for the last 5 years and the publication for the last 5 years, came out to be 4.213. So this again gives us an idea. So whenever any journal mention impact factor, we should make sure whether it is a journal impact factor or it is a 5-year journal impact factor. Fine, that because the number will not be same for both the cases. Fine. So we know there's some shortcoming to the journal impact factor. It is for a very short period of time and it is open to manipulation. It's not that it can be fabricated, but it's open to manipulation. How? Because the publisher or the editor will accept only those articles whom they feel they have a higher chances of getting cited ahead, or they will publish less number of articles. Fine. This will lead to a higher and better impact factor. But whatsoever criticism it has or deficiency it has, it is still the most important metric used in the ranking and the comparison of the journal. There are certain schools of scientists who believe that an individual scientific caliber should be based on the individual scientific output rather than on the impact of the journal. Now with this, I'll move towards the researcher performance indicators. Now, researcher performance indicators could be the direct indicator, that is the total number of the publication, how much co-authorship he had contributed, as a co-author he has contributed, and the citation counts. Or it could be a derived indicators like highly cited paper. That highly cited papers means the 10% of the paper, his paper comes to 10% most cited papers worldwide. If his paper fall in that category, that is a highly cited paper. Now, more the number of highly cited paper, the better is the research output. Then it's the average citation paper, that means the total citation received to the publication divided by the total publication gives you a number, that is an average citation paper. And the international collaborative paper, we might publish with article with so many authors. If at least one author is from the different country, this article will also have a better scientific output. This is the list. You can go through this link. You can get a list of the researchers, whether alive or deceased, of the amount of H index or the citation. And this is the latest updated list which I've got from the Google Scholar public profiles. Now come the research metrics. I'll be taking care of the three research metrics: H index, I10 index, and G index. I think you must all be aware of these three terms. I'll just give you the basic understanding how they are calculated and what is the clinical significance. Now the H index is the most, the simple index metrics, I can say, most acceptable and objective. This single number will give an idea about the productivity of the researcher and the quality of the researcher. Productivity means that it will give an idea how many papers he has published, and it will also give an idea what is the quality, how much citation he or she has. So a researcher has an H index. H of his or her papers have at least H citation each, and the other, that is the paper minus the H index, have no more than the H index, but the less than H citation. This statement I'll better understood in the slides ahead, but this H index is usually used for the individual assessment, but these days again it is used for the assessment of the universities, for the NAC accreditation, and so on. So H index also increases with the age and the experience of a researcher. So we should give a consideration of age and experience while we are comparing H indexes to researchers of the same field. Now, how to find H index? Again, there are different databases available like Google Scholar, Web of Science, and Scopus, which are automatically calculate your H index. In the Google Scholar, it's very simple. You set up your profile if you have a Gmail account, and you create a My Citation page and add your publication, and you will automatically get the H index. Now, you should make sure that the H index given by all these three databases doesn't match. Usually, the H index given by the Google Scholar is much higher than the H index given by the Web of Science and Scopus. So whenever you are mentioning about the H index, we should also mention the source of the citation index, and the universities also should make it clear during the selection or the recruitment ki which H index database tool they're using to calculate, so that there is no confusion. Now, how we can calculate this H index manually? It is very simple. Suppose these are the 12 publication any author had, and that were the citation each individual papers received. Now we arrange all these papers in the sequence of descending order, that the highest cited paper we give the rank 1, and the lowest cited paper we give the last rank, that is in this case which is 12th rank. Now as we observe very carefully, the rank 1 paper has 39 citations, and that means we can say that number 1 rank paper has at least one citation, and the rank number 2 paper has 36 citations. So we can safely say that the rank 2 number paper had at least 2 citations. So as we move down and we come to the number 8, the number 8 rank paper had 9 citations, means the number 8 paper had at least 8 citations. But as we move below the 8th rank, we see the 9th rank paper had 7 citations. So this we can easily conclude that the H index for this researcher is 8, means the 8 number papers had at least 8 citations. If you see randomly also, if you calculate, just count 36, 22, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 papers of this researcher had 8 citations each. Now we can also use this H index to compare the status of the various researchers. We can calculate which researcher is doing better than the other. Now there are 3 researchers. Again, we have arranged the citation in the descending order. In the researcher 1, the rank 1 has 11 citations, and as we move down, the rank 6 paper has a 6 citation, and the rank 7 had 1 citation. Hence, in this case, the H index is 6. In the researcher 2, the rank 5 had 9 citations, the rank 6 has a 5 citation. So in this case, the H index is 5. Now you just see, even though the researcher 2 has better citation, much more better citation than the researcher 1, even then the H index was less as compared to the researcher 1. So this, if you deeply look into this scenario, so we know this researcher was consistent. He was just writing and sending it to publication, to the article, to the journal, with a better index, with better impact factor. But this researcher, this one of his publication was a blockbuster, like must have contributed, published in a prestigious journal, or must have collaborated with good authors. But later on, his publication couldn't fetch him good citation. So if this researcher published one more paper with a better scientific quality and publish in a better journal, then maybe he might get a better citation and may improve his H index. In the researcher 3, again, the one paper had 35 citations, and as we move down, this number 5 paper has 7 citations, and number 6 has 2. So we can say the H index in this case is 5. Now, I think with this, the H index is quite clear. Now, this is, as an Indian, I feel proud to share this slide with you. The Dr. Anil K. Jain from United States has the highest H index, 188, in the field of computer science and electronics. This is from the updated data, which I gathered 16th May 2020. Fine. But we have mentioned this in the reference also. You can get the entire list of the researcher with the various H index. Now comes the I-10 index. This is the most simplest index, and it is only given by the Google Scholar, and it is automatically calculated. It means that how many papers were there with more than 10 citations. Again, it is very simple to calculate manually. TK, we have arranged the papers according to the descending orders based on the citation, and we see the number 1 ranked paper has 39 citations, number 2 had 36, number 1 we can say had at least 10 citations. So as we move down, the rank 7 has 21 citations, and the rank 8 paper had 9 citations. So we can conclude from this database that this author, this researcher, I-10 index was 7 and H index was 8. Now again, for this I-10 again can be also used to calculate the research significance of various author. I've used the same database which was used for the H index, which were the in the researcher when the H index was 6. But as we see, the only the rank one paper had 11 citation and rest all papers were less than 10. So in this case, the I-10 index was 1. The researcher two, the H index, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are very much audible.
Now in this case, something is coming on the slide. Okay, fine. Now in the researcher two, the same database who had a H index of 5, as we move down, the number 4 paper have 14 citations. Just see the difference. Number 1 rank paper had 130 citation and the rank 5 has 9, rank 4 had 14. So in this case, the I-10 index was 4. So it means in somehow this researcher was managed to fetch better I-10 index as compared to the researcher 1. Fine. Then the researcher 3rd, researcher same, we have arranged and the rank 4 paper had 12 papers and the rank 5 paper has 7 citations. So here the H index was 5, which we have discussed, and the I-10 index is 4. Although there is a huge difference in the citation of both these authors, but you can see they both have the same I-10 index. So if this researcher focus on publishing a next paper with the better quality and in a better index journal, then there is a probability that he might drastically improve his H index as well as the I-10 index. Now this is the that's the significance of knowing your I-10 and H index. This will give you an idea where you stand in your scientific community, and this will give you an idea how and where you can improve your index. Now the last index is the G index. Now G index was proposed by Leo Egge in his paper Theory and Practice of G index as an improvement of H index. Now we know that there is a drawback with an H index. H index only take into consideration only those people which have H citation, and the paper which had citation less than the H, that is H minus 1, they were not considered. Similarly, I-10 index, only the paper who had number 10 or more than 10 citation were considered. Now this drawback is taken care by this G index, because G index will consider all the paper, even if the paper who had lesser cited, lower citation, or who were not cited at all. So how it is, this is usually G index is given by publish and perish. It is a kind of an extension of a Google database, and it is this G index take into the consideration of all your papers, whether they were cited or not cited. They will take into consideration the entire publication. So I just want you, all of you, to focus on this line so that I can, it's better to explain in the working example. The G index is a unique largest number where the top G articles together is received at least G square citation. Now you just remember these two terms, and the G plus one paper have less than G plus one square papers. They were less than, this means that if we increase the number of the publication, the square of the paper will be, the rank will be more and the citation will be decrease. So therefore, this I can explain in this example because it's quite tricky. So in this, the researcher had 10 papers. Okay, again, we have arranged the citation in the descending orders. Now we add a column that is a summation of the citation. Summation of citation, top G articles together. Okay. This is the article summation, means articles together. We sum the citation at each set, and the fourth column, we do the square of the rank. Fine. Now you observe these two columns and we'll do the comparison. Now I ask you, is the summation of this citation is equal to or more than the square of the rank in the first rank paper? Yes. See, 65 is more than 1. So we can say the summation of citation is more than the, is at least or larger than the square of the rank. As similarly, the rank 2 paper, we do the summation of the citation, 65 plus 15, that is 80, and square of the rank is 4. So the summation of the citation is at least or larger than the square of the rank. So as we move down, and we move down to an ordinal number where the summation of the citation is at least or larger than the square of the rank. The square of the rank is 100, and the submissions of the citation is 115. So we can conclude from this database that this author, the G index was 10. Now to better understand, again, the same database I have used, which I had used for the explanation of the H index and the I index. In this, again, this we have arranged the citation in the descending order. We add two more columns, summation of the citation and the square of the rank. Though the rank one paper, the summation was 29, the rank square was 1. So as we move down, the rank 12 paper, the summation was 146, and square was 144. So we can safely say that the rank 12 paper had a citation together, all these citations together, at least 144. That means it was, since it was 146, it was more than 144. Again, G index can be used to calculate the scientific values of various researchers. We know which is better. I've used only two researchers. This is also one. We know the H index is 6. Summation, this is the column. Rank one paper, the summation is 11, square is 1. So as we move down to the rank 6 paper, the summation is 44 and the rank square is 36. Just below this, the rank 7 paper, the summation is 47, but the rank square is 49. Now this summation is less than the rank square. It should be the other way around. So in this case, the G index is 6. But now come to the researcher 2. The researcher 2, the summation of the rank 1 was 36. And as we move down to the rank 8 paper, the summation was 110 and the square of the rank is 64. Now this is more than 64. Though rank 8, we can say at rank 8, the summation was at least 64. Hence the G index was 8. Now if this author published another paper, the 9th paper with a 0 citation, fine. And the summation will be 110 and the square will be 9 square is 81. Now the again, this summation will be more than the square. Then this, the G index will improve. Got it? So if this author published more paper and with a better citation, his G index will improve further because there is a huge difference between this citation, summation citation and the square. More is this difference, the better will be the G index in subsequent years. Now with this, I can summarize, although the G index is not used very widely, but it is a very good index, and NAC and this university accreditation, they don't prefer to use this G index, only the public and parish, this database gives the G index for the author. But this is a very good index and we deeply studied. This gives an idea. This will give how we can improve a further publication. Now with this, I just want to summarize my bibliometric indicators. Although it was a brief presentation. See, we get so many metrics, we might get confused. Fine? We might get confused to which to use and what to use and how to use it. But whatever you use, just remember the citation analysis should always be considered in conjunction with the views of the scholarly peers. We can't do any bypass to the peer review. We should have a good understanding of the metrics. If we have a good understanding, then only we can be able to interpret the any metrics. If a H index of a young researcher or a mature researcher, we'll be able to interpret the H index. And then citation behavior varies across the discipline. So it is unwise to compare the metrics across the discipline. It is very ridiculous, unfair to compare apples with the oranges. Fine. Now the take home message from this brief presentation is that don't take these rankings too literally. Take them just as a pinch of the salt. You will be bombarded with so many metrics. Don't get confused between the general base metrics or what are the article based metrics, level metrics. Sometimes it's better to use a common sense, and this will help you to distinguish between a fair journal and a fake metrics. With this, I thank you all for your patient listening. I hope I made my points clear. If there's something you want to have a better understanding, there are the references you can go about in the question and answer session. We can try to answer those queries. With this, I request Dr. Nitika to you please proceed with the
yes. Ultimate. Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful presentation. It was indeed, it helped us to grasp the basic idea about what bibliometric indicators are all about. Though because of time constraint, we have covered it very fast, but still we have given an overview regarding the bibliometrics. Now there's another aspect to bibliometrics, and that is altmetrics. This is also called as alternative metrics, right? Because of the web and the social media nowadays have created a massive amount of available data, which is there online in the form of tools or literature. So altmetrics is basically a tool which helps to measure the frequency of mentions about an article in an academic social network like media, Twitter, blogs, right? So it will measure all the citations, all the downloaded items, all the time the article is referred, all the time the article is read on any of these medias, and all this will constitute the altmetric attention score. So it focuses on individual article rather than the complete journal. Now altmetric score can be provided by the publisher themselves, or it can be provided by a third party also, which can be altmetric.com, Noes, Plum Analytics, Kudos, Impact Story, right? They can also provide you with the altmetrics score. Can we have the next slide, ma'am?
Just a minute.
So I've shared even the picture, like in the past, this is how we used to communicate about each other. Last slide, ma'am. Yes. So, okay.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, yes ma'am. So in this slide, you can see a table here. The table, it shows news, blogs, policies, patents, Wikipedia, Twitter, Publon, Weibo, Google Plus, F100, Syllabi, Facebook, YouTube, Q&A, right? All these are the platforms where the research output can be shared. Right. And where even the academicians who do not put their research output in the print media, they prefer to share on these platforms. So the altmetric score will be generated by adding all these numbers together wherever the research output has been shared. The altmetric score is basically in the form of this donut. There are two donuts there on my screen, if you can see. But in donut one, where there are 252 research outputs that are available, it has more of the red color. Whereas in donut two, it has more of the blue color. So in altmetrics, all these platforms are color coded. Like blue is for Twitter, yellow is for blogs, red is for news, violet could be for policy documents, green for syllabi, rust for Pinterest, white for Q&A, gray for post-publication peer reviews, right? So all these are color coded, and all the articles that have been viewed, to saved, to discuss, to recommended, to cited, all these will be counted in the altmetric score, right? So basically, in 2010, a movement started to look at altmetrics, that is alternative metrics, to augment the existing measures of an article. So in 2010 onwards, approximately 8,000 journals are now using altmetrics. So this was about altmetrics. Now coming to scientometrics, it is a study of science and technology, including the interaction between scientometric theories and the scientific communications. So worldwide, scientometrics is now becoming a very powerful, next slide ma'am, is becoming a very powerful instrument in determining the extent of the way a project or an institutional funding to assess the depth. Ma'am, last slide. Isse pehle wali, Dr. Meena.
Scientometrics.
Am I audible?
Yes. This limitations.
You are audible, ma'am. Please try.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, Nitika, you're audible.
Ma'am, last slide. इससे पहले वाला ma'am. इससे again एक पहले हाँ. Okay, so I'll be briefly covering the objectives. Ma'am, should I share this slide?
I think I have this only in this, my presentation. This is there. Scientometric is the next.
Next one.
It's not coming. It's missing.
No. This is the correct slide, ma'am. These are the objectives of study in scientometrics. So scientometrics basically analyzes the input and the output. So what input is? Input takes into account the research process, which will include your scientist, the funding agencies, the organizations, the infrastructure involved, and the research program that is involved in the complete research process. Whereas the output, it is the research product. Now, what the discovery has been made, now how that discovery is made patent, and then the publications and scientific and citations of that discovery, and how that discovery can initially lead to benefit of an organization or an institution. Now, all this is covered by scientometrics. So there are two variables on which it is dependent. That is the latent variable and the other is indicator. Again, latent variable, it deals with the scientist and his research, the reputation of the scientist and how authentic the research is. And the indicator, it again deals with the citations and publications. So having gone through all the metrics, bibliometrics, altmetrics and scientometrics, they are not complete in themselves. They have flaws, and hence it is always advisable to use two metrics together rather than individually using them. Like in bibliometrics, it can always be influenced by database, as was shown by Dr. Amina. Manipulation is very easy. You cannot compare it across scientific field. You cannot compare a bibliometric a citations for a cancer journal with a nursing journal, right? And what I believe that it fails to take time into account, time being very important, because bibliometric, it revolves around citation. So if we consider time, if an author is there for almost a decade, he will definitely have more citations because it has been 10 long years of working. But at the same time, a new person or a new author into the scientific research will not have that many citations, obviously, because he's just new to that format, right? In the same way, it goes for altmetrics also. The quality of data cannot be confirmed. Anything which is there in vogue on the social media, you cannot always confirm that it is correct, right? Manipulations is possible. Tweets and likes and blogs, they can be purchased or they can be written in lieu of a favor, right? Lack of theoretical background. Sometimes an article or a research output becomes a hit overnight. Now, that doesn't mean that it will add to a scientific value to a scientific research. It can basically be because that topic might be a controversial one, or maybe that research output is trending nowadays. Right? And the data can be used for commercialization. So very simple example, if we write a post about SDF, SDF can be used by us as a periodontist to relieve small kids of carious lesions. But then the same article which circulates on the social media, any manufacturer can use that article for commercialization of his or her product because it is freely available on the social media. In the same way, scientometrics too has some limitations. It is incompleteness of database, impossibility of considering social and subjective factors because it is computer-based, non-additive additivity of the scientific data, and availability of some systematic errors in the methodology. So now I'll be sharing with you. I do have tips for researchers. Many of the people have asked this, how the citation report can be created. How can they, even that question was asked in question and answers, that how can they know about their citations, how many they have cited. So for them, I must say that you can create an ORCID ID first. You can go to ORCID.com and create an ORCID ID, or you can go to Web of Science and you can create your citation report. I will just be sharing. Dr. Meena, can you stop sharing this?
Yeah, I'll stop sharing. Yes. Just be fine.
So I will just share with you how you can create the citation report. Is it visible?
Yes. It is visible, Dr. Nitika.
OK. Okay, so this is how you can, many of the participants were asking about it. So this is how you can create the citation report by going on to Web of Science. But one thing you have to remember is the Web of Science will create a citation report of only those articles that are there and listed in Web of Science. Those that are not there, it will not include in your citation report. And your citation report, by creating the citation report, I mean to say that it will create the overall citation count that has been there, the H index, and the number of publications that you have already done. So once you go on to Web of Science, first thing is you have to add the authors. Okay, you have to add your name. So basically you go to the basic search line and click on plus more. Once you click on plus more, you will get further options of author search, structure search, and minus less. So then you click on author search. So once you click on author research, it will ask you for your last name and initials. So the example has already been given very beautifully. It is like Smith J. So the last name will be added Smith and the first name will be added as J, right? So once you've done this, in most of the times what happens is the last name is very common. There are many people having the same last name. So you can go one step ahead by adding the research domain and also the organization, the name of the organization for which you are affiliated to. And once you've added these details, you can click on to finish search. Once you click on to finish research, the Web of Science will put in front of you all the records that have your last name and in that particular research domain. So supposedly in this case, we have 126 records with the last name that you had put and of course with the same research domain and the organization. Now, if you have to go through all these records and check if these are yours. So if 126 records are yours and confirmed, then we directly go to step number four. So what is step number four? Step number four is now you have to just create your citation report, which is just a click away. You mark all your articles by clicking onto them. That is click marked list. And then you scroll down to create citation report. Here you will see create citation report. All these things will be very much visible on your computer screen once you log into it. So once you create the citation report will be shown to you in this form, in the form of a chart, right? Now, what all will it have? It will have your citations, the sum of time cited, average citations per item, and even your H index. Right now, this is how you can see it on your screen, but you can also save it by exporting the data. Again, you will see this option very much there. You will export the data and save it to your Excel file. So this is the case when all the articles that the Web of Search has retrieved are your own. But usually this doesn't happen because of the common surname. So out of 126, all the articles were not mine, right? So in that case, I will go individually and check all the articles and use mark list, and I'll keep on adding my articles to add to mark list. This add to mark list one by one by ticking on them. So now out of 126, only 52 articles were mine, rest were not mine. So I have retrieved these 52 articles into my marked list. And now if this is the complete thing which I have, again I'll go to step number four and I'll create my citation profile. However, if there are few articles which are still missing, I will save this marked list and then I'll proceed to step number three. Now, step number three is once you have saved all your marked articles, again you go back to the basic research, and in basic research, rather than selecting a particular domain, you will just select all database. So now it will search by your last name, the complete database. Whatever articles by that name turns up, it will show you those and you can select your articles. And to make it even more precise, what you can do is you can specify the author name completely or the title of the article, particularly which you are looking for, or the publication name which you have. And in this way, you will have a complete list of articles which are yours, and you can eventually create a citation report and even save them in the form of Excel sheet. So this was in brief how we'll go about it. And coming to the end, These are the references for this presentation. It was a very huge topic which was compiled because of the scarcity of time, but we hope we covered almost everything and hope all your queries were solved.
Yes, ma'am, you had did a fantastic presentation in a short time. I understand this topic required much time. So now can I ask to Dr. Kedar Mehta for his presentation? Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, madam.
I would like to thank Dr. Amina and Dr. Nitika for the wonderful presentation. You did a great job.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you once again. I'm sorry that we extended beyond the time limit, but we were really helpless. We want to make it as clear and understandable as possible. So I know it's been difficult for the next panelists, but I really apologize for that.
Thank you, ma'am. Please go ahead, Dr. Kedar.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I hope the slides are visible.
Yes, they're very much visible, Dr. Kedar. It's visible.
Okay. Thank you so much. So I would like to thank Innovative Publication for giving us the opportunity to share the next presentation about reference management. And also we would look at some of the softwares which help us to arrange the references at the end of our manuscript, right? And it is also an equally important task when your manuscript is complete, whether the references are arranged as per the journal guidelines or not, right? So let us quickly brush up some of the important concepts, like what is referencing, what is bibliography, and what do we mean by cross-referencing? So referencing or citation is a system which is used in your written work to indicate where from evidence, ideas, theories, facts, or any other information were found by providing a description of sources, right? So if I take any evidence or any other published article or any idea or any concept, and when I'm mentioning that in my own research article, it is my moral duty to give acknowledgement to that particular researcher by appropriate referencing or citing that particular article in my manuscript. Second important concept is, what do we mean by bibliography? So bibliography is nothing but the list of all the references which are found at the end of manuscript. So when you complete the manuscript, at the end, you have the list of all references, which is nothing but bibliography. And what do you mean by cross-referencing? A reference quoted in a given article that you have used as a reference. So say, for example, if there is another article under which they have certain references, and if I go to search that particular reference, and if I cite that reference, right, then that it becomes a cross-referencing, right? So reference which is taken from another manuscript. Okay? So these are the three important concepts of reference management. Now, when should we add a reference? So whenever we are quoting a method or a particular sentence or a result of a particular project, a concept, or that are published results by someone else, right? So in brief, when we are using other researcher ideas or any other parts there, we have to add a reference. And if we do not add any reference without their attribution, then we all know it is considered as a serious offense, that is plagiarism. So why references are important? One is, we want to acknowledge the contribution to those who have already done research on that topic. Second, we want to avoid plagiarism by giving a credit to the original source of an idea, piece of information, or a resource. Third, we want to support our work with the authoritative work of another author. So say, for example, I want to say that similar finding was also found by another researcher. Then to support the evidence of my work, I need a reference. Also to demonstrate our knowledge and familiarity with the topic, that how far I have done a review of literature. So what references I have seen through or have gone through, what important articles before writing my particular manuscript. And of course, to help the readers of your work to find the original source of information or ideas that we have used, right? So this is why references are important. Now, what can be referenced? It can be scientific articles, it can be books, it can be chapters in the books, it can be certain policies, government policies, or government guidelines, sometimes reports like World Health, WHO report of any other disease, if you want to cite, that also needs to be referenced. Sometimes official sources of statistics, like maybe census 2011, if I want to say the gender distribution, male, female, and then I have a census report, then I can add that report to my reference. Sometimes personal communication, unpublished documents, web pages and blogs can also be referenced. Now, sometimes we have hundreds of references in our database and we get confused how to choose reference for our article, right? So some of the tips which I found out are, one is you should limit your references to the relevant and most recent ones. It doesn't mean that the older task or the older research work, which is very important, you should not cite that. I don't mean like that, but you should cite more references which are relevant and they are recent ones. Second is cite fairly. Do not cite you have not read that article. Sometimes we do it, we are in hurry to submit a manuscript and we cite all those we have quickly gone through. But that is not the correct way. We should always cite only those articles through which we have completely read. Third is, we should always check the journal style of referencing, right? Whether it is Vancouver, Harvard, or any style, which style that journal is using, that also we need to check and keep a copy of all references, right? So sometimes it happens that the website are changing, they may upgrade their website, so that article may not be available on that website. So it is always better to have a folder of all your references together. What should we avoid when choosing references for our articles? Number one is articles we have not read in full. So if you have not read the full article, it is always advisable not to cite such reference, right? Because there may be some points which you are missing out by just reading an abstract. So it is always advisable to read an entire manuscript before citing it as a reference. Articles that are not yet published. So for an unpublished work, to cite it a reference, it's a bit dicey situation. And third is websites, especially pages that are likely to change. So as I said, if that web page is changing frequently, then that particular website to cite as a reference is a bit, again, question mark. So which are the sections in the manuscript where references are added? One is introduction, where you are trying to justify why you are doing this research study. There you should add always the references. Second is in methodology section, if you are using such a validated tool, right? And that validated tool, you want to explain it, then you can have a reference for that particular tool. Third is in the result section, you should never add the reference, right? Because result section is your own work, right? Which would never have a reference. And the third important section where references are added is discussion, where you try to discuss your findings and you compare your findings with other relevant studies, right? So in short, there are three sections where references are added. One is introduction. Second is the methodology or the method section. And the third is the discussion section. So only these three sections are there in a manuscript where we add the references. Now coming to the citation styles, there are different citation styles. One is Vancouver, Harvard, Chicago, MLA, ASM, APA. But more or less, the one which is nowadays, which is uniformly used by majority of the journal and which is approved by ICMJA, that is International Committee of Medical Journal Editors, is Vancouver style, right? So we focus on this particular style more commonly nowadays. What are the variations in these styles? Either there is a variation in how to write the names. So say, for example, my name is Kedar Mehta. Some write Mehta K, some write Kedar Mehta. So depending on that, et al. Some say after six authors, you need to write et al. As per some of the styles, some of the style mention only three authors, then it should be followed by et al. Some say it should be in bold. Some of the journal names should be in italics. There are abbreviations. There are some punctuation marks. Your DOI should be mentioned, URL, ISBN. We'll come to all these points when we are looking at an example of the Vancouver style. So let us take an example of this. So this is one of the statements: combining pulse oximetry with clinical examination can enhance the clinician's ability to detect life-threatening heart disease. And there we have quoted one and two number reference. And this one and two reference list are given below. So if you see the reference list or the Vancouver style, Richmond S. and Rancy, these both are the name of the authors, followed by full stop, then the title of that article, early diagnosis of congenital heart disease, full stop, then the name of the journal, that is Journal of Neonatology, but the abbreviation is used is JOUR, neonatal, full stop, 2000 word is the year of publication, semicolon, followed by the volume, that is 6, colon followed by the page number, that is 27 to 35. So if you see, this entirely becomes a citation, right? So this is how, this is particularly a Vancouver style of citing a manuscript in the reference. Authors followed by the name of the title, title of the manuscript, followed by the name of the journal, followed by the year of publication, volume and page number, right? So this is in brief about how to cite a reference using Vancouver style, right? And citation in the text are in the bracket form or sometimes is a superscript. As per the journal guidelines, you need to mention either it's in superscript or it is in the bracket form. And references appear in the Arabic number list in the same sequence in which they are cited in the text. So as per the sequences, 1, 2, 3, 4, accordingly, this journal, the list should be cited, right? Now, what is the importance of a reference manager software? So say, for example, this is sentence number one. So it is one and two. Number article references has been given one and two. Now, if one of my colleague who is a co-author of this manuscript says that this particular sentence should come at the end of the paragraph and some sentences come ahead, so this reference number will change from 1, 2 to maybe 4, 5 or maybe 5, 6. How many references are there before this particular sentence? That would decide the number to these two particular manuscript, right? So here comes the role of a software, right? So there are different reference manager software which would automatically arrange these articles or the references as per the number, right? So if this sentence goes later ahead and these two references will be automatically numbered as 4 or 5 instead of 1 and 2, and the earlier one which was 4 and 5, that would be relabeled as, renumbered as 1 and 2, right? So that is an advantage of using a reference manager software. Coming to the second is Harvard style. Some of the journals would say we are convenient with Harvard style of referencing. So this also software would help you to switch over between different styles of referencing. So citation, it may be if you want to change from Vancouver to Harvard or from Harvard to Vancouver, you can easily shuffle between the styles of manuscript. So here, if you see the reference list, which I mentioned in view, Sarin Y. So here Sarin is in capital, comma Y dot et al. Only one author name is allowed, followed by et al. In the brackets is the year of publication, 1998. Item analysis of published MCQs. Name of journal is Indian Pediatrics, which is in italics, 3511, page number 1103 to 1105. So here, as I said that, your reference list is arranged as per alphabetical order of the author. So say, for example, if the person's surname would be Sharma, it would be coming after this. So it would be based on the alphabetical order. It is not numbered. Here there is no numbers, but their reference list are arranged in alphabetical order. So this is an Harvard style. But as I said, most commonly we are focusing on this particular Vancouver style, where these are the reference list which I mentioned. So coming to the reference management software, which makes our task much easier, there are different softwares which are available. One is Zotero, another is Colviz, Mendeley, and EndNote. But I would focus in this particular session more on this Mendeley. Why? Because one important advantage of Mendeley is it is free of cost. We are not paying anything to download this. It is not even trial package. Free of cost by Melinda Gates Foundation. They have given this Mendeley software free of cost to all the researchers in the world, right? EndNote is also a very good software, but the disadvantage is it is a paid version. You need to pay for this. When you can have a trial version, after which you have to pay to avail the services of that particular software. So coming to the advantages of this software, it helps in storing or consulting the references. It would help to download directly from internet like PubMed. It would assure the quality of references. It would help us to sort by author, date, type, keywords. It would help to search in our library anytime using Boolean operators like AND or NOT. It also helps to have a link with the Word of PDF copies of our article, and it ability to link to your notes on article. You can also highlight some of the important points which you have read from that particular manuscript. You can highlight those particular points also. And the second important advantage is during writing an article, it would insert references into text from database. It would automatically update reference number. As I was mentioning, if that sentence is deleted and we shift that sentence to end, then the reference number will be updated automatically. And automatic change of format of references. So as I said, some journal would say Vancouver with superscript, Vancouver with brackets, right? So all those modifications, it is allowed with the help of these softwares, right? So let us quickly go through some of the important aspects of one software which I would like to demonstrate is Mendeley software. So what is Mendeley? It is a free reference manager and academic social network that can help you to organize your research, collaborate with others online, and discover the latest research. It would automatically generate bibliographies. Second is, it would collaborate easily with other researchers online. If I'm working on HIV and I want to find which other researchers are working on HIV, I can collaborate with them also through this Mendeley account. It also helps easily to import papers from other research software. So if your friend is using Zotero, from Zotero, file can be taken directly imported to Mendeley. It would help to find relevant papers based on what you are reading. There is a search icon which is available on Mendeley. It would help to access your papers from anywhere online, right? So you can access your all papers anywhere online. And of course, nowadays, even it is, we can use with iPhone application also. So this software is also compatible with mobile phone and specifically with iPhone also. So this is a website, www.mendeley.com. So if you are working on hands-on, or if you want to go further and if you have a look, quickly, directly click on this particular link. You have to sign up and you have to download particular software for the first time. And then after, you will have two accounts. One is Mendeley desktop and one is Mendeley web account, right? And there should be synchronization between these two accounts, okay? So make sure that your password and email ID should be same for both desktop as well as web-based account. This is a software and you would also have a shortcut like this appearing on your desktop when you download it for the first time. Coming to the Mendeley desktop, this is how it would look like once I have downloaded, right? So this is a toolbar where you can see there are options like file, edit, view, tools, and help. This is a desktop version. And here you can search, as I was telling, with the article. So if I want to search an article from a particular author, so maybe Nitika Singh, so I have to just type Singh Nitika and all the articles which are there related to her. If I have downloaded and if I have kept in my library, then articles related to that particular author will appear first. This is the left side is the main work icons where you would see all documents. Then you will see all documents. You can also create a folder, right? Publications, you can create all your publications. You can have it one place in My Publications. You can also add some of that in favorites. If you have some of the manuscript, you can add it in the favorite list. And you can have folders. If you see your folder, if I want to create HIV study, so that folder would be created HIV study, and all the manuscript related to that particular manuscript, HIV stigma manuscript 2020, if I give folder name like that, all articles I can sort it out in that particular folder. This is how I can filter by the name of authors also. So here are the list of all authors. Here would be the title would be appearing here of the manuscript. This would be the year in which that article has been published. This would be the when did you add in the database? When did you add that particular article? Now, how to add this article here? So I'm just zooming this particular part. This particular part, I'm zooming in the next slide. If you see here, so just below the toolbar here, there is an option called add files. So when I click on this add file button here, it would ask me whether I want to add files, I want to add folder, I would add entry manually. Usually we add files here when we click on this, and you have to click on sync with your web folder. So when you go with the synchronization with your web and all from PubMed, if you have done this article Mendeley desktop and if you syncing this, that article will be added directly here in your list or reference list, right? So this is how in the files you have add files, you can add folder, you can enter manually also if that is not available online, and if you are working with some unpublished article which you want to cite it, that also you can do it by adding entry manually from here. I can also import it from other software, as I said, if I have a library which is already done in other software, that can also I can import. Another is edit option here. Edit would have, there are some options like find, I can find a particular manuscript, I can cut that manuscript, I can paste. So it is just like normal Word document. You can cut, paste, and everything it can be done. This after file, edit, the third option is view. And in view, if you go, there are citation style. So here I can have, see, Harvard style, Vancouver style, Nature Journal style. So if you want to search more styles, you can click on more styles and say, for example, any journal related to innovative publication like Indian Journal of Forensic and Community Medicine, you can just click on more styles and you can download the link of Indian Journal of Forensic and Community Medicine, and directly that would be downloaded here. So you not to arrange the references accordingly. The citation style will take care of everything, how to write the name of authors, how to write the title of the manuscript, how to write the name of journal, everything will be taken care of by this particular software, right? So here you need to click on citation style, but majority of the journals nowadays are keeping it unique, that is Vancouver style. So please make sure that you click on this Vancouver button. So this is the citation style, and we click or we keep it usually as the Vancouver style. Tools, there are two important tools which we need to install before starting Mendeley. One is we need to install Web Importer. When you install Web Importer, M symbol will appear on your Google Chrome or any browser which you are using. So directly when you are downloading the manuscript directly from the website, just you have to click on that M button and that article would appear in your library. And another is you have to install MS Word plugin. That is, in Microsoft Word also, you should have this Mendeley should be installed. So these two plugins are important. One is for the website and one is for your Word document. So when I do for the website, if you see here, Mendeley, so this is how M option would come, import to Mendeley. This is how it would appear, import to Mendeley. So immediately, if this any article I want to import it, I have to just click on import to Mendeley, and that article would be directly downloaded in that Mendeley. And as I said, Word document, once you have a Word plugin, you would see this option M, and you have to see that insert citation. So this Mendeley ka M will be appearing here in the reference section. In your Word document, in the references, you can have this insert citation. Now how to go ahead. So say for example, this is a manuscript I've just started writing. Maine introduction thoda likha, I've just written some introduction part, and where I want to add a reference here, right? Say for example, I need to add two references, reference 1 year and reference 2 year, that India is highest TB burden and prevalence is this much and proportion is 2.1% and 15%, and I want to add a reference here. What should I do? Number one is I have to download this references in a Mendeley software, either directly from the website by clicking on the import to Mendeley option, right? Or I can insert manually, right? But usually we do the directly import it from the website, right? And when I have already downloaded that, these two references are there in my library, what I have to do is I have to click on insert citation. If you can see here, I have to click on the tab here, insert citation, right? And there will be a tab which will be opened like this, where I have to click on go to Mendeley. I have to click here, go to Mendeley, and this is what I want to cite here, WHO Global TB Report. I want to cite this particular article. So I have to click that. So if you see, that color would be changed from white to blue color. So this tab would become blue color. And then can you see your option called cite? Yes. So make sure you click that particular article, and then you click on the button called cite, tab called cite. Press cite here. Once you will press cite here, if you see here, the WHO 2012 report has come, but this is American Political Association as per the style. So what I need to do now, because I want the style which is known as Vancouver. So I have to just go down, click here on Vancouver, select Vancouver. And if you see, it has clicked to one and with the bracket, right? So directly it has come one number and with the bracket as per the Vancouver style. Similarly, here I have added a second number of reference, which was RNTCP report, and that is also in reference number 2. Once I have cited these references, I have completed introduction, methods, results, discussion, conclusion. At the end, I would have a title called references or bibliography, where I want the list of all these references to appear. So my title would be references. Sorry. My title would be references. Downstairs, if you look at it, my title is references, and then when I click on insert, I have to put my cursor there, and when I click on insert bibliography, and as I clear the concept, bibliography is nothing but the list of all references which you have cited in the manuscript. So this is how, when I click insert bibliography, both this article or the manuscript with the citation will come down, and as you see, this is how it would, WHO Global TB Report 2012 semicolon 2012, right? And this is how the Central TB Division report. So whatever way, Vancouver style, the references would be coming up. Keeping the cursor on the text highlights the line and scope for editing the text. If I want to edit something, still I can edit also here. 2012, if I want to repeat to 2013 report and to just go there and change to 2013, right? So this is in brief, I have shown the software, which is Mendeley, which is free of cost available. And you can easily download it from the website www.mendeley.com, right? So I would like to thank some of the presentations from who I have taken up, that is from the union and one of my colleague. And once again, I would like to thank Innovative Publication for giving me this opportunity. Now over to Dr. Lalit, sir, who would be quickly going through some of the other softwares, like how to go through Zotero and how do you use EndNote also while citing the references. Over to Dr. Lalit. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kedar. It was a wonderful session. I would like to announce that after the presentation of Dr. Lalit Gupta, we had the announcement of winners today. Please hear and take all the details of the announcement. Thank you. Welcome, Dr. Lalit. Sir, you have to unmute yourself.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Kedar, for a beautiful presentation. Now we are going to discuss a few more things which are paid, and it is a part of your presentation which you have just told. So what happens when a typical researcher cites a paper? So when it goes to the researcher guide, they always say where are the references and where are the bibliography. Yes, and it is the stage where the most of the papers are cancelled. And why? The problem starts from here. There is an article, there is a book, there is a conference paper, and you want citations for your paper from these three things. And it's a very tedious job because there are lots of citations and you don't know where to keep the citations and how to use them. And then again, there is the reference list as well as the bibliography. So this citation to the reference list or the bibliography is the main area where most of the mistakes are made, either in the typing, in the referencing, or in the wrong citations. So how it works? Citation, it helps in the managers, helps in giving the proper credit to the work. It provides the plagiarism. It shows how the work is related to our previous work. And for references to fulfill their function, they must be accurate. Make sure that all the information in the citation, for example, author list, author title, journal title, volume, year, pages are accurate. So you have lots of information and you want to keep them in a particular place where you can find out very easily. And at the time when you need them, you can see through them. So there comes the place of the reference management tools. As Dr. Kedar has told you, there are lots of citation stands. Well, the main is the APA and the Vancouver. Dr. Kedar just told you about the Vancouver style. I just give you the brief glimpse of the APA style, where there is a first of the author's name, then there is a year of publications, then the title of the article, then the title of the journals, issue, page numbers, as well as then follow the digital object identifier, that is the DOI of the number. So you have to keep all these things in a particular order if you want to keep your citation list update. And how it is done? It is because there is always a common reference error because of the less of organizations. You forget where to keep your file. There is no classification how to write them. And there is the hardware issues with either your desktop or it becomes in the old desktop while you are using in the new laptop. How it does then? There, organize, annotate, and manage your references. Import references from the online databases, library, catalogs, websites, PDFs, create in-text citation and formatted bibliography, share the references with other researchers and work on your references anytime, anywhere by this help of these softwares. So these are the popular reference management tools where we have just discussed the Mendeley. The other beings are EndNote, Zotero, WriteNote, ProCite and ReferenceWorks. While coming to the comparison, Zotero is free and open source, while Mendeley and Citationeasy is free. However, the Zotero is the only problem is that it also not so much popular Mendeley because it's a bit difficult and you have to further login in into these sites. Mendeley, as this Dr. Kedar told you, it's a free reference software. The desktop version is available. It has a cross platform with Windows, Mac, Linux, available in the various versions, and it has a plugin for the word processor MS Words. Create groups and share your personal library, automatically exports in the popular citation format. So this was the summary of the Dr. Kedar presentations, and Mendeley is such a useful software. But apart from that, we have the Zotero. Zotero is also, as I told you, it is a free software. For this, you have to open the Firefox browser, go to the sites of zotero.org, install, download and install, and after installation, restart the Firefox. Once you do it, then you get there is a short, there is a logo of the Zotero. Click on this Zotero logo in the bottom right of the browser once you have opened the PubMed. And what you see three types of columns in the Zotero. Left column, where the libraries and collection as well as the tags and keywords are kept. Middle columns, where their items are contained within the selected library. And there is a right column where the information about the selected items are kept. So it is basically the same as the Mendeley works, but in the PubMed, you have three different categories where you can keep your as a author wise, as a selection wise, as well as the article wise. So what happens now, if you want to make a collection, you create the collection to organize your references, create a new collections, just add the add collections, and a box will prompt you to name of your collection. You can keep any name and click OK. Your collection will appear in the left column. This is how a column is created. Now too, if you want to create a Zotero bibliography, select the item you want to include in the middle column, right select the selected items, choose the option create bibliography from the selected items. A new dialog box will appear. Choose the citation style, choose the format, and then you select the OK. So most of the time the citation style is a Vancouver or APA, and the format is the RTF or the HTML. Once you have selected on the click on OK, then this will be saved in your desktop in the Zotero software. So there is a free software, but there is also a paid version of the EndNote, which is used by the professionals, and it is very much in use with the researchers. This EndNote Web is a commercial reference software used to manage bibliography and reference when writing the articles and meta-analysis, because it has a big access than the Zotero as well as the Mendeley. Users can add reference to a library manually or by importing or exporting via the program. This is common to all the programs. And via PubMed, users can select citations such as specific format and save them as the text files, which is not present into the Zotero as well as the Mendeley. But there is a catch in the EndNote. You cannot go directly to the EndNote. For this, you have a held inter-network access to the research initiative, that is the HINARI network. It is a WHO initiative which has given that you have to log into the HINARI before logging into the partner publisher websites. Log into the HINARI sites using the URL www.who.internationalint.hinari. So it is a WHO initiative software. From where, once you have logged in, you will go to the reference. You just give the HINARI software, give the access to A to Z, all the software, all the access generals. From where you can choose your reference sources. And when you click on the reference sources, you will go through the Access EndNote Web. And once you have reached the EndNote Web, see, this is the EndNote Web, which I have just mentioned from the reference sources. Using the reference sources A to Z list, Access EndNote Web, one of three options of the bibliographic software. But the work starts from here. Once you have reached the EndNote Web, then you have to again log in on the EndNote website, but it is only for the once, since you have to make a new account. This is a sign in page, register here, click on the sign up for an account to complete the process. And once you have done the EndNote site, this registration, the process is completed and will be only for the once. After that, you go to the PubMed site, the EndNote, and select a particular article. Says like in the summary display 12 citations that previously were checked and list. Click on the citation manager, and once you click on the citation manager, you will get a file to save and export this file to the EndNote Web. Medline display list the fields that will be transferred to the EndNote. So like this, in this type of format, citation manager, your a new folder will be created. So the EndNote as well as the Zotero are just like similar to the your Mendeley. The only difference is that the few services of this EndNote, which is the collaboration with the WHO, is only accessible to the paid version, which are not in the previously Mendeley software. So to summarize that, we have the references from the Mendeley, beginner guide to using the Zotero, UBC biochemical, biomedical branch library, and Zotero quick start guide. I must recommend you to go once through these sites if you want to learn these softwares. And for the EndNote, there is a reference management software. There is a complete module is available on the net. Okay. With this, I finish my presentations, and I would like to Nikita madam to come and explain the further proceeding of this conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. Very informative information. Sorry for the short time you had today. So I would like to now ask Rakesh to announce all the winners of today's event.
Good evening, all of you. Respected all organizing committee members of International Peer Review Workshop 2020, key speakers and participants who have participated in workshop from 19, 20 and today 26 September. International National Peer Review members who have submitted assignments for hands-on experience on peer review. Thanks, Vinita Madam, to provide me opportunity to declare result of participants. I hope everyone eagerly waiting for selection of his/her name in top corner of hands-on experience peer review. Happy to announce that all peer review assignments result has get decided by three committee members of innovative team. I would like to inform that all winners' name will be displayed on international innovative website for 15 days and publishing on publishing house website. We will send a gift, a hamper and certificate with Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation ISRF membership certificate. Yes. I request all winners to send their complete delivery address like name, address, PIN code, contact number and email ID so we will not face any difficulty in sending the certificate. Hamper, if you have any query related to address, send us mail at info@ipinnovative.com. Thank you. Now I would like to announce the list of winners and 15 best winners. Reviewers are selected out of 132 entities. We received fantastic opinion from all the review articles, and on the basis of average marks given by three experts, team, we finalize the winners. First, Dr. Kirti Sharma. Second, Ishan Kumar. Third, Dr. K. B. Usha. Fourth, Himani, numbering mistake. And then fifth is Neelam Singhal. Sixth, Vikas Kumar. Seventh, Dr. Bindush Johan, 9th Amol Bansal, 10th Dr. Abib Asraf, 11th Pundo, 12th Arun Gigi, 13th Dr. Deepa Sitoli, 14th Dr. Sandeep Kumar Das, 15th Nikhil Bhujwal, and 16th Sandeep Sukhdev Gajiv. So, 16 list is there. One, there is the same name repeated 3 times. So, total is the 16.
Congratulations, you all. And I would like to thank Rakesh for announcing the winner's name. I would like to request you all, please send your contact details at info@ipinnovative.com for sharing your rewards and gift. So this is the list displayed here, even on the question answer session too, so that you can take the details of the name of winners and then send us the required detail of yours. Thank you all. So I would like to request all the panelists to start the question answer session. Please unmute yourself. What happened?
Yes, madam, we are here only.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Then you just start with the answering of the question which is for you.
I have answered most of the questions, ma'am, related to our presentation. I think the expert in the Mendeley and this EndNote, we need to answer. Some of them have asked about the Mendeley and EndNote at this thing.
Yeah, Dr. Kedar and Dr. Lalit had lots of questions. I guess they also answered a number of questions on the answer live there in the typing answer option. But if you like to share some answer directly here, then you can go ahead, please.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, so some of the questions I'm finding is, what about references which are not in Mendeley database, non-index journal? So if some of the article which are not finding it online and which is not in the database, you can add entry manually. So there was an option on Mendeley, go to file and add entry manually. You can add the manuscript reference manually, and that you can add it to your Mendeley library. So that was one. Another question is, what is an ideal number of references? There is no ideal number of references. It depends on the type of manuscript. It is a case report. You may have 9 to 10 articles. It depends on the journal guidelines. Some of the journal guidelines say for original manuscript, it should be up to 30 references, not more than that. If it is a systematic review or meta-analysis, the number of references can be up to 100 also. So the answer to this is, how many number of references? It depends on the type of manuscript, number one. Second, it depends on the journal guidelines also. Journal has some specific guidelines that these many number of references you should add on, right?
Okay.
Rest of the questions I have answered in the chat, question and answer type section.
Oh, great. So can actually Dr. Nitika have a question from some participants. So she want to elaborate it. Can you please Dr. Nitika and Dr. Amina with that question?
Sure, ma'am. So ma'am, there was a question regarding how to calculate the altmetric score, right? So, as I already told, that altmetric refers to different databases available on the social media and also on the academic media. And all these databases are given different weightage, like the news are given a weightage of 8, the blogs a 3. So if a research output is shared on the news, it will be given a score of 8. And if the same research output is shared on a blog, then it will be given a weightage of 5. So the total score will become 8 plus 5. Right, but even if there is a repetition of that same research output on the news or the news channel or the newspaper, then it will not count it twice. It will only count it once, unless and until it is being shown up or referred in some other newspaper. Right, the same goes for the tweets and blogs also. If the research output is shared on a tweet by some fellow person, then it will be counted as one. Even if he retweets it 10 times or 20 times, it will not count as 20 count. That count will be counted as one only. So just giving you a small example, like how to do brush, like the brushing technique for children. And we have, and I've published it in literature also, and I've shared it on social media also. Now, what happens is the same thing gets published in a newspaper, in a national newspaper. So my score from the altmetric score will become 8. The same thing is blogged by a fellow researcher. And so it will become 8 plus 3. And some person tweeted the same thing on the Twitter. So it will become 8 plus 3 plus 1. Now, even if he has tweeted it 4 or 5 times, the count for the same tweet by the same person and by the same source will remain as one only, right? And suppose a brushing technique has given, I have given a toothbrush, a patent toothbrush, and it has been documented in a policy document. So now that score will add on to 5. So it will be 8 plus 3 plus 1 plus 5, right? So this is how the alt metrics will derive all the information regarding your research output on various platforms and will compile it to form a one altmetric score. Now, altmetric score will always be a whole number. It will never be in points or decibels. In case it comes in points or decibels, then also it will convert to a whole number. So this is how we proceed onto how to calculate the altmetric score. So I just hope this is very clear. This was one of the questions, and also one of the questions which was there by the attendees was they wanted to know what citation is basically. So they wanted to know the difference between publications and citations. Though I mentioned it, but publication is what you have put forward, and you have put forward in the print media, what you have published yourself. Your articles are your publications. So whatever I have written and in article form, those are my publications. Could be one publications, could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 10 publications. But then out of those 10 publications, all the articles which have been taken by some other author as a reference. Probably Dr. Meena took my article number 3 to quote in her study. So that 3 was now a citation for me, right? It got cited in somebody else's article, so it was the citation. So publications is what you put in article form and what you give, and citations were how the other authors have used your publications in their study and have cited your articles. So that is the citation number. Dr. Meena, there were few questions regarding citations and
There is a continuous query about the where to send the all the details of the winners. Can you please show that slide again along with the question answer sections?
Okay.
Please. You have to send all the details at the info@ipinnovative.com.
Please show the slide so that the participant can note down and they can take the screenshot. Definitely. Because there is a continuous in the chat section as well as the question answer. They want to know the details of that.
Okay, we'll do that. In this slide, you find all the winner. Please send your details, contact details at the rate info@ipinnovative.com.
Yeah, most of the questions have been answered. I think we are running short of the time.
Exactly.
Yeah,
we have to wind up the session, otherwise it will be automatically disconnected. Thank you so much.
I have an announcement for tomorrow that we have a quiz competition tomorrow. 30 questions are there on the basis of previous session which we had delivered in the International Peer Review Workshop 2020. And for every question, one winner should be selected. So 30 winners are selected tomorrow for the quiz competition. So I would like to request you all for join the session and enjoy the quiz competition as well as tomorrow. Tomorrow is the binding session presentation on the topic future of peer review. So good night for today, and it was very fantastic to have you all here. Thank you all participants. A number of participants are come from Pakistan, China, India. So India is the definitely maximum participants we are here, but international participations are there. So we are glad to have all them, and I'm very much thankful to Dr. Amina, Dr. Nitika for their interesting interacting session on video. Yeah, and I would like to thank Dr. Kedar and Dr. Lalit for their very interesting topic today. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Good evening and good night. See you tomorrow for another scintillating session. Thank you, Innovative Publication.
Good evening to all of
you. It was a privilege and honor to be with you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.